I'm the director of the Virginia Interfaith Center for Public Policy. We are here this morning to announce the formation of Virginians for Paid Sick Days. We are a new coalition of advocacy organizations, nonprofits, unions, faith leaders, business leaders, and others who are calling upon our governor and our General Assembly to pass paid sick days during this upcoming special session, and to expand it in the future if need be. We do this because there are more than 1.2 million workers in Virginia who have no paid sick days, no paid time off, no time off at all to care for themselves and their family members. This is a crisis in normal times, but especially during this pandemic. We know that families need sick days, but we also need paid sick days for the economy to be able to open up and stay open safely. So paid sick days is not just for families and their health, it's for the entire society. We want the economy to open up. We want it to be able to stay open. And this is only going to be able to happen if we have paid sick days. So this morning, members of the coalition, members from a wide variety of sectors in Virginia will talk about the need for paid sick days. And of course, we will hear from our incredible patrons, Delegate Guzman and Senator Favola, about why we're doing this and what we hope to achieve during the special session. So we want to start first with Dr. Abdul. Dr. Abdul will have to leave us after speaking because of a room full of patients. But Dr. Abdul, why do we need paid sick days?
So thank you so much for inviting me. The paid sick day leave is so vitally important because it means that sick workers won't come into work and therefore infect other people. We had a situation where we had an asymptomatic patient who was living with family members. We asked for the family members to come in to be seen so that they could get tested. Probably only half of them did. And when I got to thinking about it, I felt that since she had remained asymptomatic, the rest of the family probably thought they could take the gamble to remain asymptomatic, and knowing that they had something would then mean that they were in that difficult position of having to quarantine for 14 days. And where were they? Who was going to keep the lights on? Where was that money going to come from for quarantining? It's easy to tell people to quarantine for 14 days, but if you don't have a safety net or extra savings or a way to get paid, it's basically futile. And so it's very important that the government step in. I'm not just a physician, but I'm a small business owner, and it would be hard for me, honestly, without government assistance to pay for 14 days of leave. But it's important that we start looking at creative ways to help small businesses and help the people in the communities, because basically what's going to happen is that sick people or as we know now, asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic spread is the majority of the way COVID virus is being spread throughout the country. And so we really need to be mindful of making it easier for people to get the care that they need. And part of making it easier is letting them know that they will still have some financial security if they get sick.
Awesome. Thank you. And you're an active leader with Virginia Organizing, correct?
Yes, and I'm the head of our local Democratic Party in Martinsville, Henry County.
Awesome, awesome. Well, we are happy to have you. We're now going to hear from a business owner, Mr. Mark Smith, who owns 5 Midas shops in the Richmond area. And he's taken time as he's traveling us cross country to join us this morning. So talk to us about why business owners often mostly provide paid sick days. Why is it?
You've almost got to, because the key to providing sick pay is your total compensation package. You want to build into a package that basically addresses long-term employability. And the more attractive your compensation package, the better that is. The more stable your work base, the better your stores are going to do. We do offer the 5 days. We offer more than that. We've also got the highest performing Midas stores in North America. It's a matter of how good your people are, which is completely a function of how you do what you do, how you present what you do, and how you compensate your people in the system. We've got a program we call Inclusive Prosperity. When the stores do well, everybody in the stores do well. And all of our folks know that. We build that into it. PTO is certainly built into that program. Benefits, all the other factors we talk about. But having that stable workforce allows us to grow our business, develop our business, grow our market share. It's a win-win for everybody. So the more stable your work base, the better your work base, the better your work base, the better your stores do. It's an all-inclusive thing. I'm a big advocate for it.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And now Tony Hedgepeth, who is a home health care worker and a member with SEIU. Tony.
Okay. Everyone able to hear me now? Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me. I am happy to be here this morning to talk about why we need paid sick leave and paid vacations. First of all, the paid sick leave, it's we need that because there are days as home healthcare workers, we go into work not feeling our best, and or we might have a little sickness, but we still have tasks to perform that day according to our plan of care, and we have to perform those tasks, you know, regularly and carefully. And when you're not feeling your best, sometimes it's not easy to do. But we do it because we are dependent on that day's pay for various reasons, family, bills, whatever. You don't work, you don't get paid. Simple as that. And it's not fair to us when we pour our heart and soul into a client, a patient or a resident, and we're not compensated for it. So we absolutely need that for our health, as well as our families, as well as the people we're taking care of. We're trying to perform infection control while we're working, and we can't do that if we're sick ourselves. So I hope we're really able to get this done, and for all of my colleagues' sake, I really appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Thank you, Tony, and thank you to SEIU for their strong support of this Paid Sick Day Coalition. And now we want to turn to our patrons who've been champions on paid sick days in both the Senate and the House, and we'll hear first from Senator Favola.
Thank you, Kim, and thank you to all the organizers who are so passionate and helpful on this issue. This is absolutely a critical issue if we want to continue to grow our economy, to come out of this pandemic, and to also keep our community safe. We have learned that, and it was a hard lesson, that people must value their health, that people need to take action when they are sick. And we cannot have workers put in the position where they must choose between feeding their families or going to a doctor to get a diagnosis or staying home because they've been asked to quarantine. And this bill, in fact, sends that very important policy message to the private sector, to the public sector, to our overall community, that it is time to change the culture on how we view paid sick days. It is time to extend this benefit to those who need it when they need it. And our bill also goes a long way, I think, in protecting essential workers who are on the front line. They are caring for our children. They are in our schools. They are delivering our packages. And some of them are providing janitorial services. They are doing the day-to-day stuff that is absolutely critical to serving the rest of us. But they're not getting that opportunity to care for themselves. And we need to change that. We need to treat our workers and everybody with the dignity that they deserve. About 38% of African Americans and 50% of Latinos in the United States do not have access to a single day of paid sick leave. And these households do not have the savings to cover their salaries or to cover their wages while they go to a doctor. So in effect, not having paid sick days exasperates that gap between the haves and the have-nots. And we have to work hard to start closing that, to close that gap. I believe that our bill will do exactly what needs to be done. It is a first step. It is not a complete step. It is a first step in moving us towards a society where every worker is valued, where everyone understands that he or she must take care of their health, and that when a child is sick, a mother or father needs to take time off from work to care for that child. I think this is a good value. I think this is a value we need to embrace. This is a value we need to work towards completely implementing. And I look forward to the legislative process and the conversations ahead. I'm sure there'll be lots of opinions on how we implement this, but I'm looking forward to that conversation because it is high time to have it. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Senator Favola. Delegate Guzman.
Thank you. Good morning. Well, I would like first to thank Senator Favola for patroning this bill in the Senate. Eileen Filler-Korn for making this a priority within the House Democratic Caucus, and Interfaith and every member in the coalition for the work they have done to ensure Virginians can have paid sick days, and also to share the individuals who have shared their personal stories, their professional stories, and how important it is just to say that, as we heard from the business owner, that if you take care of your employees will take care of your business. And I want to start with this line because it's extremely important. That bill, just in a nutshell, will provide, you know, paid sick time for full-time workers that are defined by the IRS. Now, we know that those full-time workers are workers that have worked 30 hours for the IRS, and this bill will expire with a public health emergency. We believe that it's extremely important to support Virginian workers at this time, since it's still uncertain when this pandemic is going to be behind us. On top of 40 hours, employees in Virginia will have access to 80 hours of COVID quarantine sick time during this public health emergency. And this could be used to take care of their relatives. The 80 hours will also apply to part-time workers based on of what they would work in a two-week period. And, you know, as it was, I think it was mentioned earlier, people in low-wage jobs cannot afford to quarantine for 14 days, as we heard earlier from the doctor. And for me, if we have received, hundreds of emails, and the reality is that if we are serious about stopping the spread of COVID-19, we won't put people in a position where they have to choose between quarantine and a paycheck. The struggle is real, and we have seen how, due to lack of support systems, people are showing up to work sick. And I don't blame them, as I've been there and I had to make those difficult decisions in the past. And for the Black and Brown people, communities of color that have been disproportionately affected by COVID-19, this the first step towards addressing that disparity. Or working low wage, as Senator Favola have mentioned, frontline jobs with no benefits. These are the people who have kept this country running in a pandemic, the people who prepare our food and sanitize our essential businesses. I have received hundreds of emails from organizations as well, stating that they are committed to address the racial disparities and economic inequalities and invite them to join us today, as this bill will do just that. I just will conclude by saying that no one should choose between their health and a paycheck, and we look forward to the special session starting tomorrow to have these conversations. And Senator Favola, to mention, you know, we are going to listen to both sides. We are looking forward to get, you know, bipartisan support, as this bill has affected everyone in the Commonwealth, regardless of their zip code. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Delegate Guzman. We're now going to hear from Mr. Thomas Calhoun, who is the president of the Norfolk Federation of Teachers. And he's also representing as a executive member, the AFL-CIO of Virginia. Mr. Calhoun.
Good morning. Let me say that one of the first thing you learn as a teacher is that children come to school sick. I taught elementary school 17 years in the city of Norfolk before these other positions that Kim has just mentioned. And one of the first things you learn, children come to school sick from October to March every year. Every year from October to March, there are children in the classroom sick. Somebody come to school sick in the classroom, before it's over, everybody in the classroom will be sick, including the teacher. Trust me, I could count it. I could tell you exactly when I would get sick every year, twice a year. I knew it. Then you figure out that you have to have an endless supply of Kleenex. It may seem strange, but it's not. You do not want to run out of Kleenex teachers in the classroom, because the hands will be up and they'll want to go to the bathroom every 5 minutes to blow their nose. I mean, these things seem simple, but they're true and can be quite disruptive. You must have an endless supply of tissue. Later on, you figure out why this is so. And it's so because the parents don't have sick leave. They cannot stay home with the children because they don't have sick leave. They can't stay home for themselves sick, and they can't stay home when the children are sick. So they send the children to school. It's really just that simple. Sick leave is not only the right thing to do medically, morally. You've heard from a couple of people already that it's cost effective economically. There is no reason to have over 1 million people in the state of Virginia without sick leave. And anyone who doesn't think about the effect on the children that it has, I hope they hear me or talk to some more teachers, because adults not having sick leave affects their children. So on behalf of me as a former elementary school teacher, the American Federation of Teachers and the Virginia State AFL-CIO, we absolutely support and beg for the General Assembly to pass a sick leave bill. It's good for everyone involved, and everyone is involved. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Calhoun. And finally, among our speakers, we will hear from Reverend Dr. Anthony Fludd, who is the Vice President of the Virginia Interfaith Center for Public Policy. Reverend Fludd.
Thank you, Kim. I am humbled to speak to this issue. It is our moral responsibility as business and legislative leaders, leaders at large, to recognize that the moment of opportunity in our public health and financial crisis is to demonstrate compassion, especially when our fellow neighbors, workers, employees have fallen beyond their control. To some of us, the question is not what will happen to me and my goods that I have stored up, for my unexpected emergency. But the question is, what will happen if I don't ensure that my workers are provided for? We should ask with the sincerity of compassion, what will happen if we don't provide paid sick leave to millions who are barely making a living wage? In Virginia alone, approximately 1.2 million workers, or 41% of the private sector workers, are without paid sick leave. These individuals are jeopardized on two counts, where we see health and financial crisis spiraling out of control. It is a moral imperative that everybody open their eyes and see the real enemy that had robbed and left so many to die, showing no mercy, and to find there is hardly anyone compassionate enough to need or to inquire about meeting family needs. After all, doing the right thing is worth the soul of all who are willing to act justly and more humbly. It is a test for every one of us. This is our second chance, Virginia. Not having a paid standard will put us all at risk, especially during this pandemic. It puts a test to whom much is given, much is required. Support basically doing this special thing. Workers and their family get sick. Everyone needs paid time off to care for themselves and loved ones. To diminish the spread of this pandemic, your support is paramount. All people need justice. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend Fludd. This is a growing coalition. I want to just mention the coalition partners so you can see that we are growing by the day. We have joining us in supporting paid sick days in Virginia, the ACLU of Virginia, Birth and Color RVA, Care in Action, CASA Virginia, the Commonwealth Institute for Fiscal Analysis, the Eastern Atlantic States Regional Council of Carpenters, Freedom Virginia, Legal Aid Justice Center, Norfolk Federation of Teachers, Rise for Youth, SEIU Virginia 512, Virginia AFL-CIO, Virginia Education Association, Virginia Interfaith Center, Virginia Organizing, Virginia Poverty Law Center, Voices for Virginia's Children, and many more are joining this coalition. You can get information about all these groups from our website, which is vapaidsickdays.org, vapaidsickdays.org. And now we're going to open up the floor for questions from the media.
Kim Cameron Thompson with WTVR. I'm not sure how the question, can you just unmute and start talking?
Yep, you're on. We can hear you.
Okay, perfect. So my question, I think I heard Delegate Guzman say, since I haven't seen the actual bill filed on the website, just trying to figure out how this would work, I think I heard her say that this would expire with the end of the public health emergency. Would that just be the COVID-19 80 or 2 weeks portion? Or, and I guess if passed, you know, when would this bill go into effect? So just more details about the ins and outs of, you know, would this be permanent? When would this go to effect? What happens when the pandemic ends? If either Delegate Guzman or the senator could speak to that.
I think I'll take the question. Is that okay, Delegate Guzman? Okay. The way we're talking to our drafter at the moment, and I want you to know the legislative process has a lot of twists and turns, so things may change, but this is tied around a public health emergency executive order. So the elements of this bill, all of the elements of this bill would travel with an executive order. So when the executive order on this pandemic concludes, then the benefits associated in the bill, the benefits articulated in the bill would actually conclude as well. But should there be another pandemic, then this bill would kick in. So that's the current construct of our bill. And we have 2 weeks of available leave for an individual who either has a diagnosis, treatment, or quarantine related to COVID. And that would travel, the hours accumulated would be associated with the number of hours that individual would normally work in a 2 week period. And then there is an additional week that full-time employees could use for impacts on the family. If they have to arrange for childcare or stay home with the child, then that also could be used. There's an additional 1 week in there. So that's how we have envisioned it. And we think it's a starting point. I know that that some folks want to be more cautious, and some folks probably want to be more aggressive than where we are. We think we're at a reasonable place to start a discussion.
And then again, so this would, if passed, would go into effect immediately, obviously due to the nature of COVID-19.
Well, that's, the governor would have to sign the bill and request an emergency action, and then we would need 50% of the House and 50% of the Senate, if the governor signed the bill, to have it go into effect immediately. Otherwise, it would be a January 1 implementation. It's sort of a complicated scenario. It's very hard to get an emergency enactment clause passed both bodies, both chambers. So we would need the governor to actually incorporate this and has a piece of legislation, and then get the 50% of each body to enact it right away.
Gotcha, thank you.
And if I could just add, Cameron, that, you know, we have to be abiding the rules of the special session. So the special session, you know, it is, and we're going to vote on those rules tomorrow, so you will know more about that. And it has to be tied into COVID-19 or justice reform or law enforcement reform. Those are the rules. So we have to be abiding those rules. However, I just want people to understand that the fight is not over, right? Our fight to provide basic days in a permanent basis to all Virginians continue.
This is Jackie DeFusco from 8 News. Question about just the mechanics of the bill as well. So obviously, I think the main pushback on this, pandemic or not, is just the burden, as some would call it, that it would put on some businesses. So is this effectively an unfunded mandate? How would you respond to that criticism that might likely come down? And what would businesses actually be responsible for doing? Or does the government help with this?
All of those questions are still on the table. Exactly which small businesses this would apply to, which would be exempt, if there would be any funding available, all of those questions are still on the table.
Is there anything that is, is this bill drafted already? Can we see the text of what you have so far?
It has not, nothing has been sent to the clerk. So we are still looking at numerous drafts. So I expect something, I expect that we will have to send something to the clerk probably by close of business on the 18th, when we actually convene. Could be earlier, but we're still looking at multiple versions of this.
Do you have a preference on what you would like to see in the bill?
Well, I think what I would like to see is probably a little bit more comprehensive than what other folks would like to see. So I am looking to work with my colleagues and find a compromise.
If I may, will impose a financial burden on small businesses. I'm a $9 million business. I serve through $9 million annually. If I increase my total full-time employee PTO by one day, that's $22,000 in additional out-of-pocket expense. So there will be pushback there.
May I ask the size of your business?
$9 million.
No, a number of people employed.
44.
Thank you.
But I believe that if you are already, you said you are already providing paid time off.
Yes, ma'am.
Accurate? Okay. So then you are already in compliance with the bill as long as you provide 5 days at least. The part that it's will be additional to you will be the quarantine. But under being in a pandemic and the amount of resources that are available out there to maintain your business, I think the focus of this bill is a public health crisis. And we need to be cautious of that because I don't think you would like, you know, one of your employees to show up, you know, with COVID because they don't have teams. And this is just a matter of, as it was mentioned earlier from the owner of Midas, it's like this is a public health emergency. You know, to take care of these employees so we can stop this spread.
Yes, the coalition is indeed looking at this as a long-term effort. We need long-term in Virginia. We need all workers of all size businesses to have paid sick days. But in this emergency, we're looking at what specifically can we do to move forward on this issue and support workers and families, but also to enable Virginia's economy to open up and stay open. This is a critical issue for the economy of Virginia that obviously affects all of us. Are there other questions?
Hi, this is Michael Pope. I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So I was curious if I could ask Senator Favola about more of the details about how this works. I understand that's still being worked out, but two questions on that. One is what kind of worker it would apply to? In other words, how many hours a week? Would this apply to all full-time workers and all part-time workers? Is there a certain number of hours? And then also, Senator, a second question, which is, what would you say to your colleagues in the Senate who have already pushed back on this and are skeptical about the cost to the state? So two questions. How many hours of work a week do you have to do to get this benefit? And then also, Senator, what would you say to your skeptical Democrats who are worried about what this would cost to the state?
Our preliminary analysis does not show a cost to the state. The state has been providing COVID-related benefits to full and part-time workers. We will have to go back and relook at that to make sure our language conforms. But so we are not expecting a programmatic cost to the state or local governments. And we are now looking at the business entities to see how this can be done. And again, this is very time limited. It would only travel with the executive order. The 2 weeks is specifically related to the employee and the employees dealing with COVID. And then the additional 1 week, many employers already provide to their full-time employees. They provide some paid time off. And that 1 week could be used to care for a family member or to address a school need for a child. If there happened to be a child care gap, a family member could use those days for that. We are trying to provide a safety net so that workers can work comfortably and productively for their employers, so that employers, in fact, can create the safest workplace that they can create. So employers enjoy the benefits of being open, of having a healthy workforce, and therefore healthy patrons who visit them, and a healthy community. So we're looking at a number of goals here, and they are all goals which we can say are noble and should be agreed upon. So how we get there will be the discussion. I do not believe there'll be a discussion on why this is needed. It's going to be how we get there, and you know, where the payment, the burden might fall. If some calculate that there is a financial burden, I would argue that it is in the business's best interest to provide this, that in fact it is not a burden. So that'll be the conversation.
Other questions? Again, let me remind everyone that you can go to our website, virginiapaidsickdays.org, and get more information about the coalition. This is a growing coalition of organizations in Virginia who say, now's the time. We need to get a start on this paid sick days in Virginia. Any other questions? VAPaidSickDays.org, VAPaidSickDays.org. All righty.
Thank you.
If there are no other questions, we will adjourn for the day, but we will have people available if you want to follow up with any of our speakers. And we thank you for joining us this morning. Have a safe and blessed day.
You too.
You too. God bless.
Thank you.